Good morning and a very warm welcome to day two of the annual policy dialogue co-organised by the Club de Madrid and the Bertelsmann Stiftung. We had a great first day yesterday. Our speakers delivered a compelling overview of the current state of global democracy and the key challenges that it will have to confront in order to guarantee its survival and the tools that exist to protect and prepare our democracies for the future. We already touched on some disputed areas. Take the role of the US in supporting global democracy, while the Biden administration's commitment to put democracy back at the center of US foreign policy has been welcomed in some quarters. Others have pointed to the catastrophic withdrawal from Afghanistan as evidence of a lack of support for possibly the most fragile emerging democracy. And the same here in the EU. Our guest speaker, the Spanish Foreign Minister, José Manuel Álvarez, reminded us Europe is still a continent of many young democracies. But at the same time, some states within the EU itself are showing a worrying failure to support democratic institutions, and in particular, a free media. So what else can we do to open a window of hope for democracy around the world? Hope for a new sweeping wave of democratic change based on the international exchange of good practices and innovative ideas to reboot old and young democracies alike. Or to put it in another way, as one of our other speakers did yesterday, is the problem for democracy an excess of demand over supply? Well, we'll expand on all that today. Once again, I would like to remind you that you will be able to watch our event in two different languages, in English and in Spanish. You can have the original version, or you can choose from either Spanish or English channels. You can select your preferred language on the same browser you're on now by clicking the specific language you want. And don't forget the website address is, of course, rethinking-democracy.com. On the upper part of the page, you will find a menu that links to all sections of the site. You can use it to access the program, the speakers, information on our partners, and much more. Between the menu and this broadcast, you will find a link to log in, and this will allow you to engage directly with us. On login, you can access a chat located to the right of the screen and a question and answer section below the broadcast. So we hope that you have a good experience engaging with us on rethinking-democracy.com. Now, it's my honour to introduce the facilitator of the third plenary of this year's policy dialogue. Is democracy well placed to tackle global challenges? Susanna Malcora, senior advisor to the IE University, Minister of Foreign Affairs in Argentina from 2015 to 2017, and an advisor of the Club de Madrid. Susanna, you're very welcome, and the floor is yours. Good morning.
Thank you very much. I will say good morning, good afternoon, good evening, because we are supposed to have a very broad audience. It's a pleasure to be here and to facilitate this session that its title is Democracy Well Placed to Tackle Global Challenges? And I think never like before, the world has faced complex global challenges that require an agile and effective response from governments and institutions. We have seen recently that the capacity to respond to climate change, even to terrorism, among other threats, it determines the trust in democracy all over the world and has a direct impact in its long-term survival. This session is devoted to identifying mechanisms to improve democracy's ability to address the most pressing crisis more efficiently while preserving its most basic values, including rule of law and human rights. COVID pandemic has shaken societies around the world in the last more than 18 months, putting in evidence the challenges of democratic governance in a situation of global emergency. It has cast the spotlight systemic flaws such as institutional weaknesses, information bankruptcy, social inequalities, and a crisis of trust, fundamental in a crisis. that have limited the ability of democratic countries to protect their democratic foundations throughout the crisis. He has also elevated concerns around the capacity of democracies to respond to a wider set of global challenges, such as climate change and security-related issues. The continued relevance of democracy may well be conditioned by the ability of democratic leaders and institutions to face increasingly complex and intertwined issues that require decisive action over the long run with immediate trade-off, as well as far-reaching intergenerational implications. Secretary General Guterres, in his recent report, Our Common Agenda, calls for a better protection of the global commons and better preparedness to offer collective response to major global risks. This requires decisive action within each state, but also effective coordination within the global community, including democratic as well as non-democratic states and non-state actors. What should a new global agenda for democracy prescribe to help democracies respond to these challenges? And we have a great panel with us today that will address this question and offer options looking to the future. We have Yves Leterme, Prime Minister of Belgium 2008, 2009 and 11, and a member of the Club de Madrid; Katie Thompson, Head of Rule of Law, Security and Human Rights at UNDP Crisis Bureau; Kevin Casas-Zamora, Secretary General of International IDEA; Steve Kililea, Founder and Executive Chairman of the Institute for Economics and Peace; and Jan-Pieter Balkenende, the Prime Minister of the Netherlands 2002, 2010, and a member of Club de Madrid. Welcome to you all, and let's go straight into the questions. Let me start with Prime Minister Leterme. In response to the COVID, Prime Minister, Club de Madrid has been convening a Global Commission on Democracy and Emergencies, a series of high-level reflections aiming to put forward recommendations to enhance the ability of democracies to function, to deliver, and to be trusted in future emergency situations. As chair of this initiative, what are your main conclusions so far? Where do we start to make democracies more resilient to future emergencies? Prime Minister, we don't seem to hear you.
Oh, maybe I should. I think I...
Now you are. Now you are on. Yeah. Prime Minister Leterme, over to you.
So, very sorry for that, apologies, but so happy to be part of this conversation, and good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all of you. First of all, to underline that chairing this global commission was made easier by the vice chairship of Kevin Casas, who's also in this conversation, and Aminata Touré. We try to challenge post to democracy in times of emergency by having three aspects discussed very extensively. The number one is how, let's say, the hardware, the institutional setup is affected by emergencies, how the users of parliaments, of the judiciary, of governments, how politicians and how judges, for instance, how they handle cases of emergency, what is the impact? Also, what is the impact on the fundamental rights of citizens? So this is the first cluster, we think, of issues that are at stake. The second one, I think it was Oxfam that said that the COVID-19 is a kind of inequality virus. So under the leadership of Aminata Touré, we've been working on issues as social inclusion, rising inequalities, how policies to counter social exclusion and rising inequalities, how these policies are affected and how we can improve these kinds of policies. And last but not least, it's not only about the mechanics of democracy and fundamental rights, it's not only about social inclusion. At the end of the day, it's like in most of domains of human activity, it's the people that make the difference. And so we had a third working party working on issues like effective leadership and what we call democratic culture. How do leaders use their power to to exercise that power along the lines of fundamental regulations and rights of citizens? And so we are still in the process of drafting conclusions, but I would say that we have quite a long list of concrete proposals, once again structured along these three clusters. In terms of the mechanics of democracies and the fundamental rights, we have recommendations like, for instance, advocating for a little bit more flexible rules. So to well cater for keeping in place the guarantors, the guarantees for a good democratic functioning of institutions, but still in the operations, in the concrete operations, try to be more flexible, have more flexible rules. Another kind of recommendation, the same vein, is to make a better use of digital technologies. Of course, not abuse, but still better use the possibilities of ICTs that are offered to adapt the modus operandi to the emergency. Also review the emergency preparedness protocols, which, there are lots of protocols and lots of institutions that are involved in tackling emergencies, but they're not always top of the list in terms of political attention and also managerial attention. And so to review all these processes and protocols is another kind of recommendation we make. Other, for instance, that comes closer to the issue of guaranteeing the fundamental rights of citizens is to review the legal framework for the state of emergency, to check whether there are sufficient guarantees to keep it clear in what kind of situations can you ask for a special powers, for instance, for declaring the state of emergency. What is the necessity? Is the state of emergency, is there a proportionality check? Is there also, for instance, a sunset clause, that makes it necessary to review every X time what the situation, how it has evolved? And so concerning that first cluster, we have a whole range of recommendations also that, for instance, go over the rethinking of institutional design for participation when institutions are a little bit under pressure to still foresee sufficient space, room for citizens to come in the political discussion. So this is about the first cluster of recommendations around the so-called mechanics of democracy. And I could imagine that Kevin Casas, who is leading that working party, will come in with maybe a little bit more detail. The second cluster, as said, is about social inclusion, where we have been looking after recommendations that in times of emergency can still promote more equity and more equality amongst citizens and strengthen the solidarity. And so we, for instance, advocate for putting in place oversight mechanisms to review emergency response through what we call the equity lens, to check, to have a systematic check of all the measures that are taken in times of emergency to see how they impact the equality, equal access of people. Or for instance, to audit the emergency preparedness plans for their impact on inequalities. How do they impact, for instance, less favored parts of the population, the concrete situation in their daily lives, how this works out for these people. We also have quite an important chapter and recommendation about putting in place a more inclusive social security scheme with a more global funding, universal healthcare, social protection, which is of course not so easy to organize, but still part of the recommendations. How to bridge the digital divide to avoid that the use of ICT widens the gap between, let's say, the web people and the wall people. So this is the kind of recommendations we have under the second cluster of issues namely how emergencies affect the equality amongst citizens and the social inclusion. Last but not least, as said before, it is the people that make the difference. How do leaders act? How do they behave in times of emergencies? Where, based on a good cooperation with Vitamin Trust, we've been looking into figures of all kinds of polling exercises to see how people perceive their leadership in times of emergencies and how democratic culture could be affected by states of emergency and by challenges like COVID-19 or floods or whatever. And where we see, for instance, that stressing empathic communication, having two directions interaction between citizens and leaders, and the way this is organized to a very important extent impacts the quality of democratic governance. So this is the third cluster of recommendations we are working on. The objective is to have all this work done for the end of the year so that we as Club de Madrid can discuss and also bring this report to the people concerned, let's say, first quarter of 2022. So this for an overview. It's not exhaustive, also because the work is not finished, but I think it gives you a little bit of flavor of the kind of work we are preparing. Thank you.
Thanks, Prime Minister Leterme. Clearly, it's a very pertinent work, the one you are doing, and we look forward to seeing the report because it will give us a sense in three very key areas of what needs suggestions of what needs to be done. Let me now go to Katie Thompson. First of all, let me say, Katie, thanks for being with us. Given the time difference, Katie is during the middle of the night, so we really appreciate you being with us. Let me just go through a different angle here and ask you, human rights and the rule of law are two basic pillars of democratic societies. During the COVID pandemic, 109 countries passed emergency laws to boost executive powers, and 152 adopted measures that limited freedom of assembly. In some cases, these were genuine efforts to mitigate the emergency within the limits of the law. But in others, there were disingenuous attempts to hollow out democratic mechanisms, checks and balances. Does that correspond to what you have observed about how governments handle other types of critical situations, such as security threats? What will you recommend to better protect human rights and the rule of law in future crises?
Thank you. Thanks very much for the question, and thanks for hosting us and having us here at this important meeting and on a critically important topic. And thanks to Susanna for already flagging the common agenda within which we're operating in the United Nations and the Secretary General's common agenda, which flags rule of law, justice, and human rights as public goods is a new framework within which we're reinforcing UN values as part of our work. And this is actually it's wonderful train tracks for us to be on at this time as we come out, hopefully, of the COVID crisis. I think reflecting back on the COVID period in 2020, which is something that we do every year, but in look back on our results, achievements, impacts, and the changes in world developments. When we look back on 2020, obviously, we reflected here in UNDP on the fact that obviously the primary challenge for all governments last year was to balance the need to limit some rights in the interests of the highest possible respect for human rights as the COVID pandemic hit. And that balance was differentiated depending on the type of context which existed prior to the pandemic. And so there was no set pattern. There was no set pattern in government response. And of course, as the crisis evolved, the nature of what is legitimate and the nature of what constitutes freedoms has become more and more contested. And the fact that the fundamental rights had to be held in balance by all governments, which was a challenge for all governments around the world, no matter how progressive and no matter how highly developed they were. All governments have had a challenge with maintaining this balance and actually redefining what is legitimate within the context of new issues such as vaccine mandates and mask mandates. So in that context of this real challenge, we saw a really mixed impact. However, certainly at the beginning, certainly what we saw was a response that was characteristic of how governments respond to crises and security threats in general. And so we worked actually very hard, in particular also with International IDEA, to put together a set of guidance for governments around the use of emergency powers and the protection of human rights and rule of law in such crises. We work in 170 countries around the world. Most of them are the hardest hit, where institutions and democratic processes are often at their weakest. And so our advisors on the ground were very active working with government partners in order to explain and reinforce the basic human rights values as embedded in the international covenant and civil political rights. Now, question of whether this was more or less extreme than you would normally see in any other security environment is a difficult one, a vexed one. But it's true that as we work predominantly in conflict contexts and predominantly in highly fragile contexts, there is a challenge overall that we see a gradual emaciating of democratic freedoms overall. As governments are handling increasingly difficult situations, I'm thinking and want to, you know, share the analysis around, for example, situations where there is a threat of violent extremism or threats around other forms of institutional resilience that governments may wish to be handling. Now, what's important here is to bear in mind that the context that I'm speaking of, that we're working in, are contexts where there may be absolute failed states or states that are governments who are struggling to maintain authority over the complete territory in which they occupy. And in these contexts, obviously, the very nature of democratic governance institutions and processes is from the onset already difficult to maintain. And so our job and what we do and what we think is needed is to work through a developmental approach in the long term to establish rule of law and human rights institutions that are functional before the onset of an emergency crisis and therefore can have resilience throughout a crisis. And resilience in the sense of not just functionality and efficiency, but in terms of values on which they are delivering. What does that look like in reality? Well, what it looks like is that we focus within our broader work on the Sustainable Development Goals on working on judicial independence so that there's effective oversight and effective accountability of government institutions. We focus on working with to establish accountable security services. Obviously, security services that are, if you like, the prime actor when it comes to the direct imposition of human rights abuse, and often that the interface between state and society is, if security institutions are acting accountably, one can usually hope that other institutions of and arms of government are acting accountably. So judicial independence is key to this. Accountable security services that are efficient and have effective disciplinary measures and democratic oversight, absolutely important. Next, national human rights institutions. So human rights institutions embedded in national governance architecture who can function independently, who can conduct meaningful monitoring and reporting where appropriate, where they can work on strategic litigation. The establishment of strong national human rights institutions, obviously, outside of a crisis means there's more chance for resiliency and longevity once a crisis hits. What else is needed? Solid constitutional frameworks. We work on constitutional assistance within the context of a broader development work precisely because of this. And constitutional frameworks, I think, have already been highlighted, are particularly important in terms of the black letter of the law, but also in terms of the democratic process that evolves the constitutional process. Do citizens own that process? Is there effectively a social contract being formed around the constitution as its legal manifestation? Critical part of a development framework, critical part of the rule of law. And finally, and I think, my colleague who just went before has emphasized a lot of softer elements to the establishment of legitimate government and the social contract, which are particularly important around social cohesion and addressing inequality. But a fundament to the democratic governance and decision-making and a process that needs to be actually fostered outside of a crisis context is evidence-based policymaking. Evidence-based policymaking based on fact, based on science, that allows governments to make decisions outside of a crisis that are informed and balanced, and which enable a government to explain why certain limitations on rights may be appropriate at a given time within the remit of human rights law. So the evidence-based policymaking, which is a critical part of democratic governance, sounds simple, but I think COVID has showed us it's not simple at all. And lastly, and I think this is something we can go into in more depth, maintaining civil society engagement, enabling civic space, and enabling ordinary people in civil society to hold authorities to account throughout a crisis is another main pillar of our work on rule of law and human rights. Without the civic space, obviously, it's not possible to protect democratic norms. And if that doesn't exist outside of a crisis, it certainly won't exist within one. So that's a quick run through of the core elements that we think are important of working outside of a crisis. And certainly also this was compounded and reflected within the context of COVID-19. So thanks for the question. I hope that from the middle of the night, I hope that was a somewhat coherent response to that important question.
Thanks, Katie. It was coherent. And as you said, it sounds simple. The reality has proven how challenging it is and how difficult it is to implement. Let me now move to our next panelist, Kevin Casas. Kevin, International IDEA is known for its comprehensive analysis of the global state of democracy and for linking it to critical global issues. A key global issue in coming years and an existential threat for humanity is climate change. The outcome of the climate crisis will depend on whether democracies can drastically reduce their carbon footprints and do so quickly. This will require a very strong commitment to a long-term vision from governments and citizens alike. What obstacles will stand in the way? What innovations, policies, and actions must democracies embrace to successfully tackle climate change?
Well, thank you very much, Susana, and thank you to the Club de Madrid for this very interesting invitation. And I'm very happy to be part of this conversation. To your question, for reasons that are not entirely clear to me, the discussion about the future of life in the planet and the discussion about the future of democracy have proceeded along parallel tracks without never really intersecting. And I think that's a big mistake. And it's a mistake that, at least in the case of International IDEA, we're at least beginning to try to correct. And it is a mistake because, for starters, democracies are the source of well over half of emissions of CO2 in the world. If you take the 20 top emitters of greenhouse gases, 15 of them are democracies. But perhaps more fundamentally, I mean, that alone should tell you that democracies need to up their game in terms of tackling the climate crisis if we stand any chance. But there's another angle to this that it's I think, overlooked, which is the fact, and I think you, in a way, alluded to it in your introduction, Susanna, is the fact that this is also an existential crisis for democracy. A climate change is an existential threat to the planet, but it's also an existential threat to democracy. If democracy doesn't prove able to deal with an existential crisis such as this one, I would think that the normative case in favor of democracy as a political system becomes fatally weakened. And conversely, the lure of authoritarian options to deal with this kind of massive crisis becomes all the more strong. So it is imperative for the future of democracy as a political system, for the legitimacy of the case for democracy, that democracies prove able to deal in a more efficacious way with the climate crisis. Having said that, what the evidence shows is that for all their flaws, democracies tend to do better when it comes to climate change. If you take the climate change performance index, which is a measure, you know, that is very rigorous and widely used, out of the 10 top performers, 9 of them are democracies. Sweden is in first place, and China is at a rather modest 30th place. And that's not random. There are very structural reasons for that to be the case. Democracies have a series of features that enable them to be more effective when it comes to climate change. Not as effective as they should be, but better than the alternative. And the fundamental feature is that democracy allows for civil society to organize and be vocal in demanding the correction of policies. That's a crucial feature that democracies have. I mean, I'm here in Sweden. It's not entirely random that someone like Greta Thunberg kicked off her movement in a country like Sweden. I mean, what was the last time that you heard of a Chinese Greta Thunberg? This is not random. I mean, one can also connect this to the old arguments made a long time ago by Amartya Sen about famines. I mean, there are good reasons why there are no famines in democracies, and they are connected to the fact that information flows freely and civil society is able to act on that information to demand the correction of policies. I won't be rosy-eyed about the fact that there are other features in democracies that are very problematic in terms of dealing with problems like climate change that are intergenerational in nature, that imply a huge distributional problem. And two problems, two features of democracy come to mind, particularly the short-term bias that afflicts democracy because of the electoral cycles and the tendency towards policy capture. So here I go into the specifics of your question. I mean, what can we do? Well, I'll give you a few examples, and these examples are interesting because they prove that this is not an abstract discussion. I mean, it really boils down to very specific policy prescriptions. If you want to be serious about overcoming short-termism and shift the incentives in democracies to better deal with long-term issues, I mean, you have to talk about things like constitutional provisions that enshrine the protection of natural resources for future generations, which is something that many countries are doing. We have to talk about how we increase the voice of the young people in the policy process, and therefore you have to talk, and I'm not necessarily endorsing this, but I think it's a conversation that we need to have. We need to talk about lowering the voting age, which is something that countries like Austria and Malta have done recently. We have to find ways to ensure the participation of citizens in ways that are less affected by the oversized influence from lobbies, particularly from the oil industry. And here, the question of establishing a randomly selected citizens' assemblies to discuss the questions of climate change, as has happened in the Republic of Ireland and other places, becomes important. I think that's an experience, a new way of deliberation that needs to be examined very carefully. If you talk about the need to prevent policy capture, then inevitably you have to talk about regulating in very strict terms the role of money in politics, and not just money in campaigns, also perhaps fundamentally regulating lobbying activities, which in this discussion have a terribly deleterious effect. And finally, if you are serious, and this has been mentioned already in the discussion, if we are serious about strengthening the grip of knowledge-based policies, then you have to talk about establishing climate councils and advisory boards, which is something that, for instance, Finland has done to inform the policymaking process about and around climate change. So this is not abstract. It's actually, I mean, you can boil it down to very concrete institutional recommendations, and we are working on this. Now, and with this I finish, the huge question that remains, and I really don't have an answer for that one. And it's good that we have all this bright people as part of this conversation to see whether we can see light on this. But the big question is about the speed of change. You know, I have no doubt whatsoever that on the merits, the case for democracy is being more effective in dealing with climate change is very, very strong. The big doubt that I have is whether we will get there on time. And I don't have an answer for that one, unfortunately. Thank you.
Thanks, Kevin. Again, quite a few very interesting lines of thought to follow through, and we'll come back to some of them in the second intervention. Let me now go to Steve Killilea. Steve, the Institute for Economics and Peace has analyzed all the global challenges we have discussed so far from the perspective of peace. Your ecological threat report connects the climate crisis with peace dynamics. Your global terrorism index provides insights into critical security threats. And your own latest book, Peace in the Age of Chaos, revolves around the idea that unless the world is basically peaceful, we will never get the trust, cooperation, and inclusiveness to solve these issues. Then, what must democracies do to produce the peaceful environment we need to tackle global challenges? And can democracies tackle serious security challenges and be truthful to their most basic values?
Well, I think we can tackle our security challenges and be truthful to our basic values. So I'm pretty strong on that, because as we start to look at what creates peace, we've taken an evidence-based approach to it. So we've crunched about 50,000 different data sets, indexes, attitudinal surveys, used mathematical modelling, statistical analysis, to come back to find those things which are actually associated with highly peaceful societies. And that is a concept we call positive peace. But as we look at positive peace, and then we now do the analysis around a lot of the other things we think are important for society, such as higher GDP growth. So on average, countries which are strong in positive peace have 2% higher GDP growth rates than countries which are weak. They perform better on measures of well-being and happiness, better on environmental measures, better on measures of inclusion. So what we can see is this framework called positive peace also creates an optimal environment for human potential to really flourish. And so when we look at those qualities, they're exactly what we want out of a strong democracy. So they're things like well-functioning government, a strong business environment, equitable distribution of resources, acceptance of others' rights, free flow of information, high levels of human capital, good relationships with neighbours. And all those things come together as a system. And I think this is one of the things we truly missing in the current age. And I think the last speaker and his comments on the speed of change is really important. So resilience and adaptability are the keys to it. So if you get the right structure working together, you actually create a society which has actually got momentum. So societies are moving in directions, and we put them in simplistically in terms of whether in virtuous cycles or vicious cycles. And virtuous cycles are one where all these fundamentals I've just mentioned are improving. Vicious cycles are where they're deteriorating. But what's key is it all acts as a system. Now, what you need to do, and I'll come around to it in a second, is what you need to do in somewhere like the Sahel is very, very different than, let's say, what you need to do in Western European democracies. So now, if we look at positive peace, we look at it, you can break it up into three different areas: attitudes, institutions, and structures. And the first speaker was commenting about institutions, social inclusion, and effective leadership. And they're all things which come together with this. But we can see in the major Western democracies, a lot of the qualities are slipping. And these are particularly related to things like group grievances, fractionalized elites. That's where the elites within the societies fight amongst themselves. That was, let's say, epitomized by Brexit or the last US elections, even a better one. Press freedom, so I think that's already been commented on, but globally they've been shrinking for a number of different reasons, but they're shrinking. Misinformation's on the rise. Perceptions of corruption are also increasing as well, as is measures of inequality. So in the Western democracies, these are the things we need to really look and address. And it may be, and this comes back to speed, it may be that the pace of social change is more than what many people can actually keep up with. But that needs further research to understand it. So now if we come back, and let's say I'm just going to now come back into conflict. And I'll come back to a number of the last speaker's comments, because I thought a lot of them were very insightful. So if we start to look at ecological degradation, and so we look at that in terms of what's the levels of ecological threats, we find that the countries which are really high in positive peace, which is also a measure of resilience, face very low ecological threats. For us, threats are things which a country can't cope with. So when we look at it, out of the 15 countries facing the worst ecological threats, 11 of them are actually in conflict, and the other four are on a watch list. We then look at the levels of ecological threat, and then what we do is look at the resilience of the countries, determine the ones which have got the biggest threats and the lowest resilience. What we find there, and that comes down to 30, which we call hotspot countries, of those 30 countries, 28 and we're in the bottom quarter of the Global Peace Index. So you can see there's this relationship between conflict, ecological degradation, and resilience is measured through positive peace. Now, I'm just going to finish up in a second, but I'm just going to come back to something which I think is incredibly important. And this is, I think, what's needed for democracies, one way to reinvigorate them. We have to start to really look the way we run government and attack our problems systemically. And so I'll use the Sahel as an example. So if we look at the Sahel, what you've got there, you've got Islamic terrorists, you've got military responses. You've got many of the countries are going to more than double their population in the next 30 years. It's an adequate level of water. The food isn't enough to be able to feed the people. You've got better than 2 out of every 3 people in the region being food insecure, very, very high rates of malnutrition. You've got governments which are very weak, very low resilience. So the UN does a great job. But let's say how the UN operates in these areas. So you've got UN peacekeeping, which will be looking at the conflicts. You've got UNHCR, which now looks at the refugees coming out of it. You've got UNDP, which looks at development. Again, it's silo. It may be looking at WASH programs, for example, other areas for development. You've got the UN Population Fund. Now it comes in and it's responsible for family planning. And then you've got the FAO, which may be responsible for looking at the agriculture. And then you've got business off again. If you want to tackle these systemic problems, we need to start to think about how do we structure institutions which are systemic in nature. And that's a very, very big change. Now, the last thing I'll say to finish up, let's just think about Afghanistan. The US, most conservative estimate, spent $2.3 trillion on the country. Just to drive that home, that's 100 times the annual per capita income for Afghani. What we've just given them, 10 times their average per capita income, do you think we might have got a better result? But what it says, it doesn't matter how much money we throw at these problems, unless we get the developmental approach right, we're not going to solve them. So I think I'll stop there.
Very, very important last message, no question. On how to really go about these issues. Let me now go to Prime Minister Balkenende. The Sustainable Development Goals of Agenda 2030 are the global community's blueprint to tackle many of the global challenges we have been discussing. You have long been an advocate for an inclusive approach to SDGs, to leave no one behind, but also to bring in contributions from all, including from the private sector. What can democracies do to rally an all-of-society commitment around the SDGs? And what democratic innovations and reforms are needed to make sure that the benefits of progress towards the SDGs are shared equitably?
Thank you, Susanna. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. It's an honor to be member of this panel. If you talk about SDGs, I think it has to do with the bigger picture. It is about how to inspire and how to innovate and how to implement. To inspire has to do with, as you said, Susanna, leave no one behind. Take care of our planet. Safeguard a better future for all. If it's about to innovate, that has to do with creativity and policymaking, developing new ideas and solutions and realizing breakthroughs. And the key element is, what about the implementation? And that has to do with actions and measurements. Kevin spoke about the speed of change, and I agree with him. The key question is, at this moment, are we on track or not? And if not, what can be done to really realize it? And that brings me, Sam, to your question, what can democracy do? First, let's start on the global scale. I think it's so important that we underline the necessity of measurement, of looking after the best practices, about underlining the necessity of partnerships and stimulating international engagement. I'm very happy with the activities of the Bertelsmann Foundation. They are comparing countries and their performance regarding the SDGs. That helps. So you need this type of analysis. At a more regional level, you can lay a connection with the SDGs. Let me mention the European Union. At this moment, we have the Green Deal, Of course, there's a connection between the Green Deal and the global agenda like SDGs. And also you can talk about solidarity. In Europe, we have the Resilience and the Recovery Facility. And of course, there's a connection with the SDGs. And then on a national scale, I would like to underline the importance of the SDGs. I think that the SDGs should be high on the agenda of government, governments and parliaments. The SDGs should be an integral part of government policy, not something extra. It's my conviction that the SDGs should be the hard core of policy making. And if you want to realize that, that's a matter of how to organize the governance of SDGs. I think it is always important that the president and the prime minister will be involved. That's key. It's not something extra, it should be the hard core. So therefore you must organize the SDGs in the right way, having the right governance. It also means that you must have the right policy programs. You must be able to have the right policy steps. You must define concrete policy targets. You must organize the financial instruments in the right way, and you must use the right timetables. And of course, that's connected with the necessity to have annual reportings, to deliver assessments, and a willingness to partner with others. If you talk about democracies, it's not only on the national level, it's also on, for example, the level of cities. I see in my country a lot of cities that are really willing to work in the line with the SDGs. That helps, so you need also the cities. And it's not only about, let's say, democracies, because you always have to be aware of the relationship between state and society. I read a fantastic book of Atsumoke and Robinson, two professors from the United States, and the title of the book is The Narrow Corridor, States, Societies, and the Fate of Liberty. And the message of these professors is you always must have a countervailing power between state and society, and agree with them. So if you talk about SDGs, it is, of course, a responsibility for democracies, but it's also a matter of what are businesses doing? I think it's an important issue to talk about corporate responsibility. So also companies, businesses should ask themselves, how can we contribute to the SDGs? The same counts for the role of the NGOs, the civil society organizations. And what about knowledge centers like schools and universities? In the Netherlands, all universities applied sciences have integrated SDGs into their curricula. And I've seen the results. It's fantastic to see young people first have to learn about SDGs, and then they have to develop new ideas on products, about products and services that are in line with SDGs. It's fantastic to see that creativity. And at this moment, I'm in Amsterdam, the Royal Tropical Institute, and this institute contains a SDG house. That's a knowledge center, but also a center that brings parties together. And that brings me to my last point, what about democratic innovations? I would like to mention four, as far as I can see, important elements. First thing, I think it's necessary to underline the importance of public-private agreements. In my country, we used to have social agreements, energy agreements, pension agreements, climate agreements. And that is a type of thinking that you say, if you want to reach those goals, you must work together. Cooperation between the government, business sector, the world of universities, NGOs, cities. I think it's important that you are talking in terms of what is our common agenda and how can we contribute to those goals. So therefore, you must have these public-private arrangements and agreements. That's one. The second point, you can take benefit of institutions. In my country, for example, you have the Central Planning Bureau or Statistics Netherlands. That's the Central Bureau of Statistics. It's great to see that those institutions are very active players regarding the SDGs. They are developing tools to measure the progress in realizing the SDGs. It's also about the concept of the well-being economy. So you can take benefit of those institutions if they're taking the right steps. Third element is to organize the right dialogues. It's so important that you are talking about the SDGs, but also talk about implementation. And then you can take benefit of the digital means. I have a good friend of mine, showed a book here, Professor Bob DeWitt. He wrote a book, Society 4.0, Resolving 8 Key Issues to Build a Citizen Society. And he underlines the necessity to use digital social platforms. And I think that's helpful. So if you talk about the SDGs, we need good dialogues. And my fourth element that has to do with the involvement of the young generations. It's about their future. So I would like to emphasize the fact that you must organize debates in such a way that young people can be part of it and take them seriously, take their voices seriously. So I think it's great to talk about SDGs. It delivers common goals. It also creates a common language, and it requires common action. It's important to talk about the role of democracies at this moment, and not only, let's say, democracies on a national level, also on a city level, but also see it in combination with the other actors in society. I mentioned businesses, NGOs, and knowledge centers. And last point is improve democratic instruments. So democratic innovation is really key when we talk about SDGs. This is what I would like to bring into the discussion. I think the SDGs can really be helpful to have a better world. Therefore, I'm a big defender of the SDGs. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Prime Minister. We couldn't agree more. Having been part of the process of the SDG generation, this is a basic understanding that we have agreed to. And it has to be mainstream. And I always say that budgetary implications prove how much commitment there is from governments to the SDGs. So let me go to a second round. I will start with Katie, because it will be only fair to excuse her after this round, given the time difference. We talk and we hear a lot about new forms of democratic participation, Katie. In how to tackle these issues. So the question is, how are citizens' preferences expressed? In face of a crisis of representation, are elections enough? What democratic innovations are needed to give citizens more opportunities to participate, and how? Certain things have been mentioned, but let's go a little bit deeper there.
Thank you. Thanks, Susanna. And thanks for letting me go first. I really enjoyed listening to the other panelists. Of course, the question assumes that people are living in a society and with systems that are open and with adequate civic space. And when I spoke before, I emphasized the problem of the shrinking civic space. Obviously, you know, citizens and need to be able to express themselves without consequence. The basic freedoms of expression and assembly are particularly important when it comes to democratic innovations and the potential for their success. And that those systems include national systems, legal systems, and a political culture of openness and protection, which is upheld, and the freedom from suppression or oppression when exercising the freedom of expression. But it also exists in the private domain. So, for example, in societies that are highly unequal or which are repressive and patriarchal, it may mean that a freedom of expression formally exists, but that women are unable to express that or utilize that freedom in practice. And this challenge of civic space and how it's exercised, and whether it's exercised equally across generations, across genders, across ethnic and racial divides, is really critical. And it's a challenge that is putting the SDG agenda that we just mentioned in jeopardy. It's also one of the reasons why a focus on civic space and a focus on the exercise of the freedom of expression is central to the Secretary General's call to action for human rights. For us, it's essential to sustainable peace and development, and it includes throughout periods of extreme crisis. Clearly, in addition to the exercise of civic space, there is a need for funding and underwriting of science, and I mentioned before, evidence-based policymaking. So science that can inform policy processes, and a freedom of the academia and freedom of the media, and the ability for science and fact-based engagement in policymaking to be part of the public domain, well-resourced, publicly available. Within UNDP, we focus on the data strategy and digital rights as a way of exploring how the opportunities and limitations of the digital world enable fact-based policymaking to become more accessible to the ordinary citizen and to allow citizens to inform policymaking in return. So using innovative technologies, it is possible to reach actually communities who may not have previously been engaged in such processes. Obviously, there are limitations in that, and there are human rights concerns within the use of the digital domain. But what we have seen is a huge uptick in the access of ordinary people to serve or to basic services and to the ability to obtain fact-based information, guidance around the implementation of the SDG agenda, as has been highlighted by the last speaker. So the focus on civic space and the focus on the active feeding of civic space to make it healthy, so it's fed with facts, it's based with, fed with science and not with disinformation and misinformation, are critically important in terms of democratic innovations. It probably shouldn't be the case that facts and truths are innovations. But in this case, I think we need to highlight that the preservation and underwriting and funding of this domain is particularly important. I also want to just highlight another piece that's very important and has become increasingly important in the context of the COVID pandemic, but in the many intersecting crises that we're experiencing of the climate crisis and COVID, which is around human rights defenders and the challenges of protection of human rights defenders. So we've seen huge upticks in reprisals against human rights defenders at national and local levels around the world in the course of the last couple of years. And this is an important focus for all of us, particularly in the UN system. And the health and the health of a democracy and the health of the democratic innovations that we're using is really measured by the extent to which human rights defenders can be protected and allowed to do their work in any given society. So a focus on human rights defenders is a focus on the health of governance as a whole. And so we really want to focus on how we can work to ensure that human rights defenders are upheld or unable to do their work, are able to speak freely and are able to function without fear of threat or violence. And this is a particularly important component, which sounds, again, not necessarily innovative, but I want to highlight it because I think it's become of particular importance in the last couple of years in the context of an epidemic of disinformation. This piece becomes particularly important. So just three things I wanted to highlight: the civic space piece, the use and defense and the defense of facts and the investment in science and the investment in evidence-based policymaking. And finally, a focus on support to human rights defenders, the protection of human rights defenders within the context of crisis in particular, I think I'd like to flag. I'm sure colleagues are going to add to this long list, but those are the things I think I'd like to highlight today.
Thank you, Katie, and thanks for your contribution. Clearly, the Secretary General brought to the forefront this question of misinformation, and he introduced a word that I really like very much in his report, which is infodemic, the notion of a pandemic or epidemic of misinformation. So thanks for your contribution. Let me now go to Prime Minister Balkenende. I'll try to use a different order in this question. What is your perspective on this issue?
Yeah, thanks, Susanna. If we talk about democratic participation and new forms of it, it has to do with the distinction between structure and culture. If you talk about structure, then it's about institutions, free elections, elected bodies, democratic institutions, countervailing powers, freedom of expression. It's so important to underline how to strengthen the institutions instead of blowing them up. And it's also a matter of respect the countervailing powers instead of destroying them. And the last thing has to do with the element of culture. It's important to have a democratic mindset. I would like to underline that. It's about democratic values. And there are some rules of the game that should be respected. Democracy is not just a matter of having the majority. No, it is how the majority should take care of the minority? Is there a willingness to have a serious debate with the minority? What about the arguments in the political debate? I think these things are really key. It's about the quality of democracy, and therefore you need a democratic mindset, the willingness to have a real and open dialogue. And if not, then you can see the wrong developments regarding the function of democracy. It's all about transparency, honesty, and integrity. And that has to do with the issues like the freedom of press. I think digital means can be used. That has been discussed also yesterday. We have to think about the social media, because the social media can lead to new information, exchange of views, but it can also be a disgusting affair. So the question is, how can you use the social media in the right way? And the last point I would like to make is surveys can be very helpful. I spoke with a good friend, Martijn Lampert. He's a director of Localities, and they made a very interesting survey. And it was recently published, and it was called Surging Mass Recognition of Threats to Planet and Joint Willingness to for Action. It's so good to know more about what is happening. In any case, it's so important to talk about the quality of democracy. I'm very happy that Club de Madrid is doing so much regarding the function of democracies. And I'm concerned about a lot of developments worldwide at this moment. And if you want to talk about the things that have with quality of life, you must underline the importance of quality of democracies. And therefore, I'm very happy with this discussion, because it's about the future, a good future for all of us. Thank you.
Thanks, Prime Minister. Let me now turn to Kevin.
Thank you, Susana. Look, I mean, I'm just going to make one point about this question of participation. I already mentioned a few specific prescriptions that could be talked about to enhance the space for participation in a democratic system in ways that would be functional to tackle the climate crisis and so on. But there's a general point here. I think, you know, what we've seen over the past few years in terms of the headwinds that democracy is facing globally, even before the pandemic, but, you know, particularly over the past couple of years with the pandemic, this is the time to be bold in terms of reforming democracy. This is the time to embrace innovation. This is the time to refrain from simply protecting a status quo that, quite frankly, in the perceptions of citizens around the world, is to some extent failing. So really, this is the time to think about new institutions, new ways of deliberation, particularly considering that, you know, to be very frank, with very few exceptions, including, for instance, the emergence of political parties, but, you know, with very few exceptions, the basic setup of our democratic systems has been around for over 100 years. So I would say that the time is up to think about new ways bringing citizens into the policy process, and hence, you know, the question, for instance, of citizens' assemblies, of bringing young people in a more active way into the policy process, because ultimately they're going to live with the consequences of the decisions that we make today. So this is the time to be bold. I mean, if we don't do this now, you know, after this huge crisis that we've had, that has shown in stark colors the shortcomings of democratic governance in most places, we're not going to do it. I mean, this is the time to be creative and to be bold and to embrace the spirit of innovation when it comes to democratic institutions.
Thank you, Kevin. Let me now go to Prime Minister Leterme.
Thank you very much. It won't come as a surprise that I fundamentally agree with Kevin Casas. I would put it a bit blunt by saying that representative democracy as it works today is based on 19th century institutions, well, institutions engineered and reviewed in the 19th century, and so you making use of the party system, which is a child of the 20th century. And meanwhile, we are trying to tackle challenges of the 21st century, still using and only using this very worthy institutions of the 19th century and trying to organize our political debate through party membership, which is, let's say, a concept of 100 years ago. So I think, as Kevin Casas rightly has stated, we have to be innovative and try to engineer new systems of what I would call a more liquid feedback from people that exercise authorities, linking people that exercise authority with their citizens. I think democracy, at the end of the day, is fundamentally about legitimacy of decision-making, the fundamental human right to have a say in your own future, and the number two, accountability and the equality among citizens in exercising this, this legitimacy check. And secondly, the accountability check. That's the fundamentals of democracy. But the idea that of representative democracy, that at a certain moment, every 4 or 5 years, you give your vote to people and then they exercise the mandate based on that vote, they implement it, and after 4 or 5 years, they come to be accountable and to have, the blessing of the electorate. This is only a part of the story. And like we see in other domains of human activity, this has to be completed by new schemes. And I think this kind of concept of liquid feedback, which means that you gain legitimacy through vote, but also through efficiency, effectiveness, and the check on efficiency and effectiveness throughout the years of exercise of power, and not only at a certain moment where the final vote is, so to say, I think this is crucial. And I think we have now tools to better organize this liquid feedback. We have already been elaborating on some aspects of ICT, of the use of ICT in democratic debate. I saw in some countries, for instance, that social psychologists have been working on COVID-19 crisis impacts and how this, so not only medical scientists and not only politicians, but people that have skills in trying to know very well how public opinion is evolving, how people are affected in their daily lives, their feelings, how they look at things. So to summarize, I think that indeed we have to try to get our acts together to organize a more liquid feedback and liquid accountability checks than just the more static ones that are linked to institutions that were engineered some 200 years ago. And we have to complete the tools we have today and we use today by making use of what modern times offer. And this is ICT, this is a better education, people are better trained, want to have a say in political debate and get more and more, show more and more a lack of interest if they only get a chance every 4 or 5 years to say what they think about the issues.
Thank you, Prime Minister. And Steve, your view?
Well, I think we've got to realise that the belief in democracy in the West is decreasing. All the polls in most countries have finding that, but people are getting more dissatisfied with democracy. And this kind of, and a lot of people are looking at things like misinformation as the underlying reason for it. But the problems go deeper, much along the lines as I mentioned earlier on. So I think we really, and the concept of participation, I think, is particularly important. But if we look at the pace of change, what we find is new technologies have come along. And when we look at the legal systems, it takes time for the legal systems to catch up with new technology. So we see the rise of social media, and we see the advent of sort of marketing driving the messaging around social media, and that's around the advertising, so that people see the messages which most align with their beliefs. So they end up in narrow echo chambers which just reflect back the beliefs they've got. So in time, we're going to find that laws will catch up with this and will get better, but that's not the case today. And so how do we actually rectify this? I think, one, in many ways, we need to fasten the pace of laws to actually look at the way we regulate social media. But although you've got a rise in misinformation, we've also got a rise in accurate information. I can sit here at my desk now and I have access to information like I've never had before in my life, and it's improving as every year goes past. I think tied up with the improvements in technology now, you've also got more what I would call political overreach. Technology gives you the ability to be able to have power, and you can put power in all sorts of ways, and that can be through having QR codes to determine if someone's gone to a restaurant, where they've been, and track them. You've got access to their telephone records, you've got access to their bank records. You've got the ability to be able to watch their cars as they go past and capture them speeding on the road, justly or unjustly. And so politicians now have got massive more control over people in democracies than they've ever had in the past. And how this comes back and affects people, we have little sight on. But we do spend a lot of time looking at inclusiveness, and I think it's a very, very good thing. But the one thing I would say on this, when we're looking at inclusiveness, it's in the power structures, and that's within corporations or whether it's government or even within the leaders of civil society. It's the educated. So people without a university degree, more often it's two or three university degrees, their opinions are shut out from the decision-making processes. So some way there's a need to be able to re-engage the ordinary citizens in society. And there's been a couple of comments made about citizens' assemblies and deliberative democracy. And I think these concepts of deliberative democracy are very, very good at tackling certain types of problems. But there are others where you need really deep expert levels, which are very, very difficult. But I think there's a need, I think one of the ways to reinvigorate is with these deliberative democracies or citizens' assemblies. So I think that'll help a lot. But for me, when I come back to it, the innovative change which I think we need, and the one which will take us out of the 19th century and bring us into the 21st century, is the concepts of reinstituting our systems along the concepts of systems principles. And it's very, very different. We quite often think we understand and we know systems, but the principles of being able to understand a system and to put in the appropriate responses and the way to deal with it is very, very different than what we actually think a system is, and very different than the way we're governing now. Most societies would seek to have a steady state or a homeostasis. And so we don't even really understand our societies and what that steady state it's trying to seek is. Societies have intent. Societies are only an extension of human beings. All human beings, as we know, have intent. We all have intent. So we don't even understand really what the intent of our societies are, let alone the encoded norms and the way they function. So we come back to a steady state. You try and change a system, it'll try and come back to that steady state. And that's good in many, many instances. Other instances is bad. And so these are just a couple of the principles you need to understand on the way a society structures and operates before you can start to think about putting an effective government in place. This gets a lot more complicated as well. Could talk about path dependencies. All cultures are all societies are on a path which is determined by their history and their cultural norms. If you change them too radically, you're more likely to break the system. So how do you change when you're looking at it from a systems perspective? It's many, many nudges from many, many different directions, and that can create changes in the system. And once the system's changing and moving in a direction, it can be moving towards a virtuous cycle, which is the thing, which is then a self-reinforcing cycle, which is the things we very much want.
Thank you, Steve. Let me share with you. We have quite a few questions from the audience. We have only 10 minutes left. So I will go for one more question and I will seek your support in trying to make this sharp and direct because we are running out of time. So let's talk about, we have been speaking about democracies, what democracies need. Let me now ask you how to relate to non-democracies. I mean, tackling these challenges that we have discussed, it required decisive decision within state, but it also requires coordination at the global level. So that will include partners that are democratic states, but others that are not. How should democracies relate to non-democracies in tackling global challenges? And what guide rails and red lines should democracies apply, if any, when it comes to protecting democratic values while cooperating in these global challenges? So let me start here with, let me say, Prime Minister, the term, I'll start with you.
I think the most important one is a challenge we are faced with ourselves. It's to improve the quality of our democracies. Let me say this a little bit provocative. I think that what people want is to, of course, have a say in their own future, but also they want efficiency and effectiveness. And legitimacy comes with the voters' consent. But it's also an issue of efficiency and effectiveness. Very efficient policies can gain legitimacy and support by people without the, let's say, the formal structures of democracy sometimes. And on the other hand, we see that lots of our democracies, including the bigger ones, like the US democracy, for instance, they show some flaws, I think, and I continue to be a little bit provocative. But today, you can see in the US democracy, and the initiative taken by President Biden is excellent to gather around the values of democracy. But if you look at the US democracy, I'm not sure that the agenda setting today in Washington, that this is really reflecting what would be a sound functioning democratic interaction between leadership and citizens. I can give some very spectacular examples, like we all know. Think about the issue of weapons and the issue of violence in U.S. society, and the demand to have more restricted access to weapons, and how this is always made impossible by the lobbying, by the NRA, by the financing also of electoral campaigns and candidates. So, I mean, these aspects really have to be. We have to make sure that the quality of our own democratic institutions, the way our democracies are organized, that this quality is there, that we are delivering this quality. And I could give other examples also in Europe, where you see that, for instance, the balance between the rule of law and democracy and the fundamental liberties on the one hand and democratic expression sometimes conflicts, like in Hungary and in other countries. So to summarize and to answer your question, I think in interacting with non-democracies, I think we would help ourselves by trying to improve and to fix the issues we currently have in some aspects of the functioning of our democracies.
Prime Minister, you call on us being humble, and I think that's a good suggestion. Prime Minister Valkonen, over to you.
Thank you, Susanna. When we talk about non-democracies, I cannot forget, let's say, the future of young generations worldwide. And I would like to underline the fact that we need long-term thinking. I think short-termism is the biggest risk for young generations. That brings me to the non-democracies. I think you must have, in any case, a kind of dialogue. So I think the SDGs deliver, in any case, a basis for common reflection that can be helpful. All the countries have subscribed, in fact, the SDGs, so you have a kind of common denominator. You can talk about it, common language, common actions, common goals. That's one. Second point, if you talk about the non-democracies, it's not only a matter of government-to-government relations. It's also a matter of do not forget the opposition. take care that you are in contact with NGOs, businesses, universities, and so on. And the third one is don't be afraid to use sanctions if appropriate. Maybe it's difficult, but sometimes you have to say you went too far. And we see too many examples, and we have to be honest about that. My last remark is about hope for the future. So therefore, it's important to talk about what do we have in common? How can we work to have a better world in which no one will be left behind? So therefore, again, I would like to underline the huge importance of the SDGs. Thank you.
Thank you, Prime Minister. It's great to come back to the SDGs as you propose. Let me now go to Steve.
So very quickly, I think it's very difficult for democracies to actually have really fruitful relationships with the authoritarian states. However, things like climate change, biodiversity, ecological degradation, and things that they should be able to rally around in common. So if you can find the common issues to work together, you can. But I think the thing we really have to avoid is that we don't drop our morals and our ethics when we're dealing with authoritarian relationships simply because of the business, because we can do a good business there, or alternatively, there's some geopolitical advantage in terms of lining up with them. So I think on the issue of ethics and morals, we really have to walk a tight line.
Thank you, Steve. And now I'll go to Kevin.
Thank you. I mean, look, this is something that I've been thinking about quite a lot, because I happen to be part of this discussion group on the relationship between China and the West, which is a very vexing question. I mean, how we collaborate while at the same time standing for our values. And I would say, you know, this is a difficult circle to square, but I would say there are four premises that I would like to lay out there. Premise number one, we need the active and fruitful collaboration of democracies and China specifically and beyond, but China in particular, to confront global challenges and to realize human rights. Premise number two, in order to realize that collaboration, we need to be pluralistic with regards to political systems. And here I'm going to go out on a limb. We need to accept the fundamental legitimacy of each other's political systems, of China. And that means, in practice, that we have to reject any attempt to aggressively try to subvert each other's governments, including by the use of cyber threats and stuff that we're seeing these days. And we have to be mindful, we have to understand and respect historical sensitivities, which in the case of China are very important to understand why they have the system they have. Premise number three, every government has a right to promote in non-aggressive ways the values they believe in. And premise number four, we all share an interest in upholding the human rights commitments that have been universally accepted and ratified. A fully human rights compliant humankind is peaceful and free. So the fulfillment of human rights is a common human good. And as Prime Minister Balkenende was saying, the SDGs embody a critical part of the agenda to realize a human rights. The area of disagreement is mostly confined to civil and political rights. And here, to me, it's crucial that we establish the principle that no country is above criticism. For some of the reasons mentioned by Prime Minister Leterme, we need to be humble about this. No country is above criticism. And hence, it's not legitimate to retaliate against anyone for expressing an opinion about the commitment of a given country to the human rights. I don't see, and here there's a difference in the way we see countries behaving. I don't see the US sanctioning anyone for saying that their adherence to the death penalty is shameful and aberrant. But I do see China going after people for saying that they have concentration camps in where they're interning Uyghurs. So when violations are of an intensity and a scale such that threaten the realization of the human rights agenda, there should be a sanction to pay. So this is my imperfect attempt to square this circle. We need to collaborate, but we need to stand up for values in non-aggressive ways, in ways that do not imply denying the legitimacy of the other's political system.
Thanks, Kevin. We are coming to the end. This doesn't mean that we have exhausted the issues at hand. On the contrary, I think we have left a lot of appetite for more questions. And I will not even dare try to summarize what we have discussed, but I will just highlight a few things that I believe are critical. Pace of change. This has been mentioned time and time again throughout the conversation. One thing that has come out is evidence-based policy, evidence-based decisions, knowledge-based decisions. This goes contrary to the misinformation that prevails in so many decision-making processes. And it goes to the point made by the Secretary General on infodemic and the need to tackle that. Participation, of course, and we have discussed that in a very, very broad way. Bold in reforming democracies, recognizing that we have institutions from the 19th century, parties that came up in the 20th century to resolve the challenges of the 21st century, and we discussed different ways to really come up with some new ideas, including the use of technology. I love the work liquid feedback that was proposed by the Prime Minister. Humbleness. I mean, as we reach out to others, as we talk with others, we need to recognize that there are imperfections in all democracies, and we need to come out with a humble position, recognizing that. And last but not least, from my perspective, the underlying effect that Agenda 2030 has in all of this, and how this, which is an agreement, a global agreement, we accepted, we recognized this, we promoted this in 2015, 193 countries did it. That should be a driving a principle for our action, including SDG 16 that addresses the question of rule of law that we have discussed, which was very, very clearly and difficult to include in Agenda 2030, but it's there. It's one of the interlinked SDGs. So with all of this, and not this is not at all a summary, doesn't fully reflect the richness of this conversation, I want to thank all the panelists. I want to recognize their huge, huge investment in this conversation, and look forward to seeing you in another setting in the future. Thank you. And thanks to Club de Madrid, of course, for convening us.
Susanna, in fact, it was an excellent summary, and many thanks to you and to our former Prime Ministers and our distinguished guests for that outstanding panel and constructive debate. So we can now take a break. For the rest of the morning, please reconvene here in our virtual plenary at 1300 hours Central European time for our next session, a conversation on authoritarianism between former presidents of states, leaders and activists. They will be reflecting on how the rise of authoritarianism is becoming an existential challenge to our democratic societies. So don't miss it, and see you later on at 1300 hours.